Forests are extremely complex, and when you have a very complex system, it can sometimes be helpful for us to develop a simplified model to help us understand the processes that are occurring. For forests, the four-stage model of stand development is one such model. I've already made a video on this model, so if you haven't watched it yet, please do so before watching this video. The four-stage model is great and works well, but it has a few shortcomings, especially related to forests like we have here in coastal British Columbia, where we have very long-lived tree species. One limitation of the four-stage model is that it assumes stand-initiating disturbances are severe and leave no living, mature trees in the subsequent stand. In reality, even severe disturbances often leave small pockets of surviving trees, and these trees become a legacy that lives on into the subsequent stand. The model also focuses heavily on living trees and assumes minimal or no disturbance subsequently through the stand's history. And lastly, it focuses heavily on the early stages of stand development. Stand initiation plus stem exclusion plus understory reinitiation can take about 80 to 100 years in these coastal forests. But Douglas fir and western red cedar can live to be 500 or 1,000 years, so 80 to 100 years is really a very short portion of their lifespan. Recognizing these limitations, in 2002, forest ecologist Jerry Franklin and his colleagues published a paper proposing an 8-stage model of stand development that's specifically suited towards forests with long-lived species. The first stage of the 8-stage model is disturbance and legacy creation. As I mentioned a moment ago, even severe disturbances rarely cause 100% mortality. So this model recognizes that there are going to be some living legacies, some mature trees that likely survive the initial disturbance. And there will also be non-living legacies like snags or coarse woody debris that result from the disturbance. The legacies remaining from the initial stand are a bit disturbance dependent. In a fire, for example, much of the biomass of the stand will be consumed, and if there was advanced regeneration, it will likely be killed even by a low-intensity fire. On the other hand, if you have a severe windthrow event, that's not going to consume any biomass, and the mortality is going to be heavily focused on the mature canopy trees, and if there was advanced regeneration in that stand, much of that would probably survive and come to dominate the subsequent stand. This stand was managed with a clear cut with dispersed retention. It's a clear cut, but a number of large trees were left to remain in the stand. These trees were specifically chosen to be ones that were wind firm, that would be most likely to be able to withstand the much higher winds that they're exposed to now that they are no longer in a closed canopy forest. So these trees, in essence, form the legacy of this stand. So they will live on into the subsequent stand as reflected in this model. The stand has been planted. As I walked around, I saw western red cedar and Douglas fir that had been planted. But these legacy trees here that are left behind serve as seed source for natural regeneration. So in addition to the planted trees that were a bit bigger, I also noticed Douglas fir and western red cedar that had established on their own, likely from these trees or some of the trees in the adjacent stands. And as usual, there was also a bit of western hemlock since that regenerates in these areas as well. The second stage in the 8-stage model is cohort establishment. In this stage, a new cohort of trees establishes on the site and begins growing into a new stand. This cohort is strongly affected by the legacies of the previous stand. For example, if there were mature trees that survived the initial disturbance, they can remain to be sources of seed for that establishment. Or if advanced regeneration had begun growing prior to the disturbance and some of it survived the disturbance, it will have a head start in establishing itself in the new stand. This stand that I'm in here is a managed stand, so there are some legacies, but the legacies are essentially that of a harvest and planting. In the area where I'm standing, this is a bit of a lower area in this stand, so a wetter area. So the trees that have been planted are western red cedar and some western white pine, you can see off to my right here. And then further up the hill on a drier area, it's primarily Douglas fir. The third stage in the 8-stage model is canopy closure. In this stage, all the trees that have established themselves are completely filling the available space. So in essence, you could consider this forest stand full. No new trees can establish themselves. Because of that, there are really low light levels within the forest. You can see it's quite dark around me, and I'm actually on the edge of this stand, so it's a little bit darker even further in. That density also results in a few environmental changes. For one, the relative humidity will tend to be higher, which can be beneficial to these trees, especially under drier or droughty conditions. They're also pretty well protected at this point, especially from wind. Because they're so densely packed, wind, when it hits the stand, dissipates pretty quickly. So they're pretty well protected from wind throw at this point, and that allows them to devote a lot of their growth to getting taller because they don't have to devote so much energy or resources to growing their stems wider. The fourth stage in the eight-stage model is biomass accumulation and competitive exclusion. Once the canopy closes, trees grow rapidly, competing for resources. Franklin notes that self-thinning may occur in this stage, but some naturally regenerating stands may not have high enough density of trees for self-thinning to take place. In addition to the self-thinning, the lack of light in the understory will often cause self-pruning, meaning that lower branches of trees die because there isn't enough light to justify the tree putting the resources into producing that foliage. Because the stand I'm in right now was planted, its density is a bit lower than what might be found in a naturally regenerating stand in this area, so the self-thinning and mortality has been lower. However, as the stand continues to develop, I would expect to see increasing levels of self-thinning and density-dependent mortality. The fifth stage of the eight-stage model is maturation. During this phase, the pioneer or serial species of trees approach their maximum height and maximum canopy size. At the same time, shade-tolerant plants, including trees in the understory, reestablish. The stand that I'm in right now is a naturally regenerating stand. It regenerated after a fire about 150 years ago. The serial species or pioneer species here would be Douglas fir, although other species like Western red cedar and Western hemlock probably regenerated at the same time. There are quite a few big Douglas fir and big Western red cedar in this stand. A number of them are 1 to maybe 1.2 meters in diameter, and they're relatively tall and have large crowns. There's a lot of regeneration of hemlock, which is a really shade-tolerant species that regenerates well in the understory, as well as just other plants in the understory here. Along with the shade-tolerant trees in the understory, the canopy is developing multiple layers. As I look around, I see a fair number of Western hemlocks of varying sizes in the understory, but there's also a fair amount of foliage throughout the whole length of the canopy. A lot of these big trees still have branches well below their crowns that have foliage on them. Some of the legacies of the previous stand are still visible. I see a Western red cedar snag that's probably about 40 meters tall. It has a huge hole in it, the middle of it, with a burn scar on it, and it's a bit over a meter in diameter. So that's a tree that has been here as a snag for the past 150 years. The last three stages of the eight-stage model are considered old growth stages. Stage 6 is vertical diversification. In this stage, a complex multi-layer canopy develops. In essence, there's continuous canopy cover from the forest floor all the way to the top of the canopy level. This occurs as shade-tolerant species grow and come to occupy intermediate and co-dominant positions in the canopy. At this point, the dominant canopy trees are typically experiencing density-independent mortality. But what's funny is in the understory, especially the shade-tolerant regeneration, may be quite dense, so it may be experiencing density-dependent mortality. Stage 7 is horizontal diversification. In this stage, gap formation is the dominant process, and these gaps are often large and may be expanding gaps, such as those caused by disease where an initial tree might be infected and then it spreads outward over time. These large gaps create a fair amount of light, and that causes much more regeneration in those gaps. And so over time, these gaps develop in different locations, and this creates horizontal diversity across the stand. The final stage in the eight-stage model is pioneer cohort loss. In this stage, the shade-intolerant pioneer species of the stand still occupy positions in the canopy, but they are totally absent from the subcanopy and understory because there isn't enough light for them to regenerate. So over time, these trees will die from senescence, from old age death, or fine scale disturbance, and they won't be replaced by subsequent individuals of the same species. So this pioneer species will be lost from the stand over time.